Hello, everyone, and welcome to the European Road to BlizzCon. I'm your host, Seltzer, and we are live in the beautiful city of Prague in the Czech Republic with eight of the finest Hearthstone players in Europe. Today, we are going to determine which four will qualify to move on to the Hearthstone World Championships at BlizzCon in beautiful Southern California. And tomorrow, we will continue to determine the Hearthstone champion of Europe. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please let me introduce you to our top eight players. We have Maverick from Millennium, Hoy from Na'Vi, Tice from G2, Nairia from Liquid, Life Coach from G2, Jira from Pwned, we have Oskaka from Na'Vi, and we have Pavel from Empire. These are your top eight players, and they're awfully ready to start the game, so I'm gonna hand it over to our casting team now. Nimsh, how are you?
Welcome to the championships road to BlizzCon, European road to BlizzCon. We are here in Prague, in Czech Republic. There is Heroes, there is WoW, there is Overwatch, but there is also something really familiar that feels like home. There is Hearthstone. And we are going to tell you the tale of eight European finest. My name is Marcin Nimsh Filipovic, and I'm here with exquisite storytellers. Janne Savit Mikkonen, Dan Frodan Cho, and also Jakub Lofar Szygulski, who's going to join with us a bit later. Savit, what does it mean to become the European champion?
We're going to crown our first European champion ever here. It's something that you really want to become. It's a title that will last with you forever. Not only that, $10,000, ticket to BlizzCon. There's a lot on the line to fight for.
It is a great title. And Dan, who do you think is going to take that title? Who is going to advance? Man.
You're going to really make me pick right off the bat, Nimsh. It's really hard. I mean, I think this tournament is probably the most stacked Hearthstone tournament I've seen if you just look at the density of players. Every single one of these players, whether it's the popular ones like Life Coach, and you see the up-and-comers like Hoy and Oskaka, but you also have some dark horses like Jira. All eight of them are capable of winning. I can't really pick one, but I mean, I have to go with some of the favorites here. I think Life Coach here is absolutely one of the most dominant players in 2015. It's really exciting to see him conclude the year here in Prague, Czech Republic. It's an awesome atmosphere. I couldn't be more excited.
So Life Coach is your pick for the final. Who else?
I think Maverick is also a person to do really well too. I think people haven't been paying attention to him because he's part of the French community and people don't really see him as much perform. But every single time I've seen him take the stage and play games, it's been wildly impressive. I think Maverick versus Life Coach are two players to pay attention to this weekend. But then again, I could also be completely unsurprised by how some of the other players perform.
I want to hear Savitz then. What are your picks for the tournament?
Well, I gotta say that I think Nairia's chances are really good. Obviously, I'm the same team with him, so I also have the knowledge that he's been practicing really hard for this one. So I think he might go far. And another player to look out for is definitely Pavel. Every time I watch him play, he does a lot of small things correct. He does those like really small things that might maybe to newer players might not be that obvious, and you might not even notice it happens. But it's just like I get impressed by his play a lot.
Yeah, that's why we have Savitz here, to explain all those small things.
Yeah, absolutely.
Be able to interpret how all these plays are really next level.
Well, I would like to see Tice in the final because he was really consistent for the year. He had a lot of championships under his belt. He is a great player. And, well, I'm really curious to see Jira and how is he going to do. He is an Italian player, and, well, he qualified. He was the only player who qualified from the last chance qualifier.
Yeah, all the seven other players are professional Hearthstone players. Jira, coming to the only player to come through the last qualifier, he has a lot to prove here, I would say. It's going to be exciting to see how he plays.
But the first match that we are going to see is Hoy versus Oskaka. Let's hear what the players have to say.
There's a lot of practice into this tournament because I kind of know what decks there will be. There will most likely be like Patient Warriors, Druids, and Handlock. And I know I'm going to face Oskaka, and I know he likes those sticks.
My opponent is my teammate, Hoy, and I know he's a really, really strong player, but I feel like I have a pretty good idea of what he's going to play, and I've prepared specifically for him, so I think I have a good chance of beating him.
It's really awesome to like play on a big stage with a huge audience, and like every people watching your plays. And it's also a little scary, but it's like it just motivates me more for like doing the right plays. It's really awesome feeling. we're on the same team, of course. But at the same time, I know what he kind of brings, but I still respect him a lot as a player. But I think I will take this time.
To qualify for BlizzCon, you need to obviously get a little bit lucky, but I mean, always you can always improve your odds by playing the best decks and playing as well as you possibly can.
To qualify to BlizzCon, you have to do like a hard work. You have to understand a lot of matchups and yeah, just a lot of preparation and figure out what playstyle is your best playstyle.
BlizzCon is the biggest event of the year in Hearthstone, and the amount of prestige in it is insane, so qualifying would mean a ton. Honestly, this tournament is like incredibly stacked. I think the top 8 in EU is maybe the hardest tournament of them all, and if I would have to pick one, maybe it would be a life coach, but I think the average pro level here is like really, really insane.
This tournament is probably the hardest tournament I've ever been in. All the 8 players in this tournament are top tier players, and yeah, it's gonna be really hard, but I will do my best because I think I'm at my best form.
The Battle of the Brothers, right off the bat. And I talked to them before the tournament started. Both of them are confident to take this match. Even though the classes are different, they're still happy to play their teammate. What do you guys vouch for, Savit?
Well, I don't think they're happy to play each other straight away. It's pretty rough, but it's double elimination. Both of them might make it out of the groups. I can't pick a favorite here. They're both kind of equal in skill, I would say.
I think experience goes a long way. There's both of these players, even though they're extremely talented, one of them does have a lot of stage experience, and that's Hoi. He's actually been playing a lot in offline events, and I think that's actually going to help him a little bit, because when he first started playing a few months ago when I was first meeting Hoi, he definitely felt like he was nervous a little bit, and there were some things that were setting him off edge. Osaka's still getting used to that too, because for a while, there was a joke in the community that Osaka would always fall one round short of qualifying for everything. You see Hoi a lot recently. He's the one going to qualifiers, but Osaka would always lose in the semifinals, like every single time. But now he's actually starting to make that push too. So both these guys, they're relatively newer to the stage, even though they've been playing Hearthstone for a long time.
All right, guys, the players are ready, and the casters for the first match are going to be Froden and Savit. Have fun, and let's watch some awesome Hearthstone.
All right, thank you very much, Nips. So first match of the day here is going to be Hoi versus Osaka. Like you mentioned, 2 teammates on Na'Vi, a new team that's been formed in Hearthstone, along with 6-0. I'm really excited to see what these guys can bring, because not only are they very excellent technical players, but they also think very differently from the normal conventional pro.
Right. It's a little bit surprising to me that Hoi is not bringing a Warrior at all. Warrior was one of the classes that before the tournament, we were thinking probably everyone is going to bring. The Patron Warrior is considered extremely strong right now. Even Control Warrior is quite all right. But right. Hoi going with his Druid Hunter Paladin. Let's see how it works out for him.
All right, well, we're going to start off with a matchup that I don't know if people were expecting to begin it. It was Priest versus the Druid, and it's not just any Priest, it's a Dragon Priest.
Yeah.
And this is starting to get really popular since the Grand Tournament released just a month ago.
If you told me yesterday that we are going to start things off with the Priest in the first game, I wouldn't have believed you. But Ostkaka is bringing it here, and it might be partly because he's playing against Hoi early on and might have been trying to maybe counter the Hunter a little bit.
Absolutely. The Hunter is something that's specialized to Hoi. He really likes this class. Even though I know some people who haven't played Hearthstone in a while will be like, isn't Hunter always good? Not really currently. In fact, it's kind of a weird stay in the metagame where a person who brings Hunter is a little bit unique and different, which is something I didn't think I'd say ever in the history of Hearthstone.
Yeah, it's quite amazing. I'm kind of happy with that to be the case.
Yeah, it's cool. You know, Rexxar's very misunderstood, I think.
Yeah, misunderstood is fun. One way to put it.
Well, Hoi immediately had an opportunity to innervate out the Shade, but he chose to hold on to it. I think he wants to value whatever he can play in his following turns.
Oh,
because
yeah.
Very off the bat, like, innervating the Shade means you're kind of all in on this one creature.
Yeah, he doesn't have anything aside from those 2-3 drops right now when it comes to minions, so that innervate might help him to get out an expensive big drop faster.
And over in Osaka, I mean, he does have an opportunity to grab the board preemptively. You do want to consider that Druid on turn 2, now with the Grand Tournament, has 2 ways to ramp, not just Wild Growth, but also the Darnassus Aspirant. So being able to get that on board early might mean him some valuable board control in the following turns.
Yeah, and he does coin it out. He knows that the Druid does not really have a card to deal with that straight away. The Vrath is only 3 damage. Wow, Hoi, picking up the Wild Growth here. That's a great draw.
Yeah, it's huge. It allows him to basically allow him to ramp into almost any card outside of 7-mana minions, and that should be able to take care effectively of any Druid card following.
Yeah, Hoi still needs a little bit of help from the top of his deck. Those minions are not going to quite cut it. Yeah. He needs some card draw. He needs the Azure Drakes. He needs something like Ancient of Lore. Those type of cards.
Yeah. And Oskaka now has minions on board, which is one of the most important things you want as Priest. Priest's hero power is so good if you have minions, and that's oftentimes a struggle. If you don't have anything on board, it just doesn't do anything.
And especially against Druid, like that power shield, that kind of board is extremely difficult to remove as a Druid. Like, how do you deal 5 to a Cleric?
Not very easily. I mean, you need minions on board first. Maybe you need some removal spells in tandem. And now Hoi is stuck in that awkward position. Sure, he hit Wild Growth, but now he's going to be floating mana almost no matter what he does. And you know, as such, the Priest is going to be using mana very effectively. And also, too, the Shade of Nakfamis is much slower.
It is. That's the answer to the Ancient of War. I was gonna say that the next turn, if the Druid player Hoi is innovating out the Ancient of War, there's no answer to it. But that Shadow over Death. Oh, Oskaka is in such a great position right now.
He is, and something that he has to also consider is what his opponent can do both on 5 and 7 mana. So it's one of those things where he's going to prepare for in case of the normal 5 drops, such as the Sludge Belcher, the Druid of the Claw. But what if Dr. Boom comes out? What if Ancient of War comes out? These are the kind of positions that Oskaka is considering, whether he's choosing Dark Cultus or Valence Chosen.
I'm trying to remember if Hoi took his time on turn 1 with the Innervate, because if he didn't end the turn immediately, it might have signaled that he has the Innervate.
Right.
So Oskaka might be expecting to see a 7-drop here on turn 4, actually, because of the Wild Growth.
Right, and if you're over in Hoi's land, I mean, as much as the Pilot Shutter is very nice, you can use your mana very effectively this turn, and every single turn you don't use Innervate, it gets weaker, because the whole point is that you're utilizing more mana crystals for how much you have, and the ratio gets smaller the more the turns pass.
Yeah, this is a big risk for Hoi if he chooses to go with the Innervate Ancient of War here. He knows that if there is no answer, it is so powerful.
I mean, there's 6 damage on board, so it's like, how does this even contest the Ancient of War?
And something like Vol'jin is not available just yet. Oskaka only gonna have 4 mana next turn, and the Ancient of War, he goes for it, and he's gonna not be happy to see that Shadow over Death come down.
He doesn't, and you know what? This is really good position, like you said, for the Priest. And the Druid, the recovery is not even that good, too, because the Pilot Shredder now will get answered by the Blackwing Corruptor on curve!
Wow.
Yeah. Although the Shade is starting to grow. I mean, it's 4-4 is still like reasonable. It can kill this Wormrest Agent and start making the board more effective. And Emperor Thorazin's not a bad draw.
Not bad. The discount's not all that helpful right now, only discounting the Big M Hunter Roth and the Piloted Shredder. It still seems like it might be the only play.
Yeah, absolutely.
He just saw one Shadow of our Death happen, so If there's no Valence Chosen or anything like that, it's possible that it would get a 2-for-1 just from the trades.
Okay, well, I mean, he does have to weigh which option here feels better. Emperor Thorazin does make his hand cheaper, but ultimately, what does that accomplish? Not too much, because most likely he'll be able to play his hand anyways the following turns.
His options are really limited here.
Is there any world where he wants to just play the Pilot Shredder over the Emperor Thorazin? Because it feels like it gets bullied too easily.
And Rot? Yeah, I think that gets bullied too easily, like you said. I like unstalling the Shade here.
Sure.
He knows that it's unlikely that there's the second Shadow over Death, and now there's 2 things to deal with.
Sure. It's true, you know, in a very odd way, it's very complicated for Priest to deal with this if they didn't have the Holy Nova.
Right.
But, you know, it's one of those things where, like, he has to specifically have this one card.
But, I mean, any of those, there's a lot of options for Oskaka here, actually. I wouldn't be surprised if it just went with something like a Blackwing Corruptor and trading for the Emperor, leaving up that Shade for now. He could also attack with Dark Cultist into the Emperor, then go for the Holy Nova for the full clear, if that's what he wants to do.
Would you bother drawing a card as well? Like, you can bump into the Shade of Naxxramas, heal up the Cleric just a little bit. It will be at a 1-6 afterwards, which is pretty hard for it to deal with still.
Wow,
he's not afraid of the Emperor.
That's a really bold play.
Yeah. I mean, I like the idea of playing Blackwing Corruptor because it's a lot of power on board. But it's also one of those things where maybe Oskaka's evaluating that Hoi hasn't had the most easygoing hand. and you have to play it off curve a couple times. And in the end, the Emperor is not as powerful for three cards compared to like a six or seven card hand.
I think it's still an interesting decision because normally when you see an Emperor, you're like, okay, that cannot stick around. You know, you're playing up against Druid. What if there's an Ancient of Lore coming down?
Right.
Like,
which draws more cards.
Yeah. But on the other hand, he already pushed Toy down to 15 HP, and if there's a Lore, then some of the board is not getting dealt with, really. And because the Emperor is trading for the 5-4 in that case, because you can't really... Can you go for the Cleric and just take 8 to face?
Not really, because the Priest there can not only do damage, but it also can keep the board sticking around and really punish you.
Right.
I'm not sure if you're worried about drawing cards from your opponent versus dying at a certain threshold. So I can definitely understand that for sure.
Okay. Doing what he can to clear this.
Yeah, he's going to go ahead and try to play more minions onto the board. That Innervate's not really helping much. Do you think he holds on to his Innervate, or he just pushes it out for the Big Game Hunter?
Yeah, he's going to hold on to it. Getting the Big Game Hunter here would just make him even weaker to AoE.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Again,
interesting.
Again, some interesting decisions.
So the Wild Pyromancer, is that a common card in Dragon Priest? Because I feel like I haven't seen that
in
a while.
No, it's usually a card for the control type of Priest. I don't think I've ever seen it in Dragon Priest. That's really interesting decision from most Kaka. I believe that's targeted against the aggressive decks, like that that Hunter that I was mentioning.
Yeah.
Even though it could be a mid-range version.
Could be a Hunter. You know, Wild Pyromancer is also really effective against Paladin these days. Because there's so many one-health minions.
That's absolutely true. Like, clearing the Master for battle easily with something like a Power Word Shield, that's a game-winning move on turn 3.
Absolutely. And you know what's really funny, too, is Hoyt actually did bring Paladin. We're not sure about one of those the popularity of that class specifically. It's very peculiar. Alright, so Oskaka choosing now to kill Thorsten. He feels like, okay, you know, maybe I can play a little bit slower. I don't have to rush him down by, like, shooting the face.
I like it a lot how Oskaka played that. The Emperor value was almost zero. Just look at that Hoi, just with the Big Game Hunter and an Innervate. It didn't matter at all. Wow, that was really well played from Oskaka. Good call there. Not worrying about the Emperor too much.
And Hoi picks up a card that doesn't help him that much. In fact,
not
it doesn't
at all.
Really do
That's
anything.
The worst possible draw, I believe. Well, maybe the second Innervate. No, well, but he used one. Yeah, so that was the last one in his hand. So I don't think there's anything worse.
This and the Wild Growth both effectively do nothing. I mean, at least the Darnassus Aspirant puts a 2-3 onto the board, but in the grand scheme of things, you can't deal with this Blackwing Corruptor. The Big Game Hunter can't target it, and you might just die in a couple turns it hitting your face, and you can't control it.
Right.
All right, well, one thing that he might be able to do is to pressure his opponent with the threat of the combo, right? The one thing that Drew is really good at doing is Force Nature Savage or ending the game in a very abrupt manner.
But look at that. With the Wild Pyromancer and Holy Nova, he could potentially just clear all of that.
Whoa, you're right. That, I mean, that's something that you're not expecting either because the Pyromancer is not supposed to be in Dragon Priest.
Yeah, and something like Valence, Joseph, and Holy Nova would be one mana off.
Yeah, that's
this
right.
It's really unexpected. I would imagine that he's going to go for it, but... There are some options, like he could just go for maybe Twilight Guardian, kill off the Aspire.
Sure.
I wouldn't be too surprised, but...
Most likely you can kill the Shredder first, and then Holy Nova with the Pyromancer, so that way you can benefit off of potentially clearing everything.
Yep, that's
but
true.
Are you always scared about the possibility on what's on the other side of the Shredder?
Yeah, I guess it's you can take it first, to know for sure, but I would probably just go for the Nova here first.
He's playing around Mana Wraith as well as a possibility. Right. And it's a 2-health minion.
Yep.
Perfect. Works for me.
Perfect for Oskaka. And Hoi, only with a miserable Innervate.
He needs Ancient of Lore to swipe right now. That'd be the exact combination.
Oh, wow, that would have been amazing.
Yeah. Even then, it's still looking very hard to come back from. And this is a position Druid is not used to being at all, but that's what Dragon Priest excels at. Because they're able to grab the board so convincingly, Druid can't do anything to it.
Yeah, that's why Dragon Priest is so strong, because of how mana efficient the minions are, how strong the buffs are if there's no silence on those. The Valence, Josen, Power Word Shield that we saw earlier was so hard to deal with.
Yeah,
and
precisely.
Now with that silence gone, once the Valence, Josen does come down, it's... Like, how do you remove that minion?
Mm-hmm. Now, of course, this is starting to come down to the final phases of the game. Oskaka, he's up by a significant 4 cards over his opponent, and one of them even cycles and draws a card. So he's up a lot, and he already used a Big Game Hunter. It almost doesn't really matter what he chooses to do, but he's also thinking about, you know, what kind of cards could Druid use in this scenario to come back?
Well, sees his last card and comes
That's it.
Nothing you can do there.
Game 1's in the books, and the road to BlizzCon for the Europe Finals begins with Oskaka grabbing a first win with Priest.
Yeah.
What a time to be alive.
Can you imagine? This is such a huge upset, at least for me. I didn't expect to see Priest at all, even less that I would see it straight up and win a game. Wow. Yeah.
And now this is a Conquest format for anybody who hasn't tuned in since last year's Road to BlizzCon. What we do is instead of the winning deck stays on, the winning deck's actually eliminated, and you have to win with every other deck in your lineup. Yeah. So with Priest gone from Oskaka, he has to win with his Druid and his Warrior. Meanwhile, Hoi, even though he lost with his Druid, still has every class available. He can choose the Druid again, or he can choose whatever class that he feels like is best.
And what do you think he's going to go for here? Is there any strategy involved, really?
In Druid versus... You have to evaluate which classes are generally the best against the remaining. You definitely want to be able to at least grab a win on the board. Being down 2-0 isn't the end of the world, but it's definitely tough to climb
that. It is. It's really tough.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And, you know, I think both these players definitely understand what it takes, though, to climb. You look at Hoi, for example. He's been in tournaments where he was on elimination point. I remember the first tournament that he played, as you can see that maybe he's queuing up the Hunter there.
That might be. Yeah.
The very first tournament that he was able to perform in and grab a bunch of his points for the Road to BlizzCon was the Viagame House Cup number 2. And he lost his first 5 games. And if he lost the 6th game in a row, he would have been eliminated. Right. He was 0-5, and then from that point on, won every series in the tournament to win the whole thing.
That's so crazy.
In the loser's bracket. So it was a very, very tough road for him, but he did it. And I feel like no matter how down you are in Hearthstone, you have to always have to maintain a positive attitude. And who knows, you might be able to climb up and defy the odds.
Yeah, definitely never give up. There might be a Shredder from the top that your opponent plays.
Yeah, you never know if the draw off the unstable portal will save you.
Yep, and Hoi does go with his Hunter.
The Hero Hunter.
Yeah, Oskaka with his Druid.
All right, so Druid versus Hunter has been a storied clash for years now. A lot of people debate whether or not it favors one or the other. How are you feeling about this matchup in the most recent times?
Well, it definitely got better for the Druid with the new expansion. Darnassus Aspirant is an amazing card against Freezing Trap in particular. Mm-hmm. That Freezing Trap used to be maybe the toughest thing to deal with as a Druid. All you can do is a Force of Nature, but if it comes down earlier, what exactly do you freeze?
It feels
Shade?
Like there's there's not really main things that you want to freeze and make sure the Druid can't leverage onto the board. Yeah. However, you can use Freezing Champ very tactically to stop Innervate from controlling the board too much, and then as a result you lose too much damage. So I do think Hunter generally still has good opportunity to tempo, but it's very reliant on its curve.
Yeah.
I think you have to get those early minions. You see in Hoi's hand, he has all spells. Yeah. He's going to want to land into other things like Mad Scientist, into whatever falls into this one mana slots, if it's Leper Gnomes or Web Spinners.
The Aspirant that I mentioned, that's one of the reasons why Hunter has also gotten less popular, because of the Druid matchup getting weaker and Druid being so popular nowadays. Interesting decision from Hoi to keep that quick shot.
Yeah, so he hates Darnassus Aspirant so much, he wants the quick shot on turn 2.
Oh, well, that's pretty risky, because there we go. Does pick up a 2-drop, because in case he did not find a 2-drop, Hero Powering turn 2 would be a disaster.
That's right. And you want to save that Owl. I know a lot of people are like, well, play on curve, right? No, you don't want to actually toss out the Owl there just to be eaten alive by the Lions.
Usually, if he knows that Oskaka is running Ancient of Wars, we don't know if he is, but if he is, then it can be a big move to just keep that for the Ancient of War. Otherwise, how do you get through it? How do you get through an Ancient of War? If there's
not
no Hunter's Mark
at all.
But usually if there's an Owl, then there's no Hunter's Mark. A lot of people then they choose one of the two and not play both.
Mm-hmm. Well, in this case, Oskaka does have access to an Innervate. He chooses to go for Druid of the Claw very aggressively, hoping that his opponent does not have Hunter's Mark to gain some tempo. But even if he had a Kill Command.
Kill Command, that would be a good Kill Command right there. But it's not there.
Well, so now that Hoi can't kill this immediately, he might just opt to play for something for the most mana-efficient, most powerful minion, which is, I'm looking at the companion. Animal Companion.
What if he rolls a Leo? That would be so bad.
Huffer,
okay.
It is usually Huffer, but in this scenario, is it what you wanted?
It's okay. I mean, it's kind of the same as Misha, so I suppose that was the best thing he could have gotten. Or maybe not, because then he would have saved 4 HP, because then the Druid would have to attack into the Misha instead of going into phase.
Oh, it's an excellent point, because if you played the Misha, then you wouldn't have this doing damage, which means Druid might not race you as aggressively.
Right.
4 HP is a lot, if you think about it.
It is.
Oh, well, the druid definitely does not change into the spider. You don't want to pick up that unfavorable trade. Let your opponent do the attack.
Oh, this is a rough draw from Hoya. He needed a strong minion to play here. Even something like Juggler would have been reasonable, but the web spinner, not that good.
It's something. I mean, it's at least a minion that he can place onto the board, and you always have your opponent hesitating, like, does he have Houndmaster? Do I want to kill this minion off as a priority at all? At least it's something.
But he's definitely curving out a bit clunky here. Keeping that quick shot might be kind of hurting him here. But I'm not saying it's a mistake, because if there was an Aspirant, that would have been the best way to deal with it.
Right, and I think it's one of those things where you keep it because you're expecting a worst-case scenario. So maybe Hoy thinks he's generally unlucky. Like, I don't want to be able to be stuck in a position where I can't answer it.
Right. Do you think there might be something about the big stage and all, maybe affecting the decisions? Because that's actually one of the things that I've heard many people say, that when they're playing under a lot of pressure, that you think that your opponent has the worst thing more often than if you were just playing the ladder. Because the ladder, you're just more willing to take risks.
Mm-hmm. And being aggressive in Hearthstone is definitely weighing the likelihood of them having the response perfectly or you being too safe. And sometimes if you're too safe, you give up your chance to have an advantage or even win.
Yeah, it's
good. So you have to be very cautious, but so far for Hoy, it's generally been okay. Like, Alskarga does have some awkward cards in hand. We didn't really mention that he has the Force of Nature and Savage Roar, but that's unplayable for the entire game so far.
Yeah, that's too early for those. Mm-hmm. So Force of Nature gets played quite often just on turn 6 against the Hunter. There's usually things to clear with it. But for turn 5, do you really want to keep her? Especially not on a board like this.
Okay. Well, Hoy doesn't pick up a beast for 2 mana, but he does have Jungle Panther, which might help. I mean, it's one of those things where Druid can't really remove it. It might be a Kill Command activator. It might get some really good trades early on. So it's definitely one of the pretty decent above average beasts.
Absolutely. Piloted Shredder from the top. That's definitely a good card. He was hoping for 5 drop, but you can't be too sad about that. This is not the time for Keeper of the Grove. There could have been something like Savannah Highmaid for turn 6. So keeping the Keeper is for Gaga's point of view, it is necessary.
Now, do you Savannah Highmaid and bump into the Shredder at all? Because there is a worry about swipe potentially being very threatening, or you don't necessarily want the Shredder to be contesting the Highmaid very easily. Because if he had the Keeper and a Wrath,
there's a song on YouTube that kind of encourages aggressive playstyle.
Okay,
I think he might have
seen
that one and just,
All right, fair enough. Oskaka in this position, well, he does have silence. You want to have the ability to remove the Hymen's death rattle impact. Having those 2/2 hyenas is so hard to deal with for Druid. So you, generally speaking, you want to silence it, but how do you follow up to it?
This is pretty rough, because using the Keeper and Hero Power here means that you're taking 6 base damage. And looking at 4 power on the board more, he would be down to 12 already just from those. So he might be considering the Force of Nature here just to not face tank that 6. But getting the Keeper on the board, getting another body, it allows him to deal with those 2 ones later.
Although something from the Shredder could help him. Okay. Well, that's not really the most helpful thing.
Maybe Unstable Ghoul, whatever would be good.
Explosive Sheep, something to help deal with the board. Maybe some kind of taunt would have been excellent there.
Double quick shots.
Okay, so with 2 quick shots and Hero Power, that's 8 damage, plus the 4 on board. So he's missing 5 right now. He's got 12 damage.
It's hilarious how good the Jungle Panther is because of the weak AoE clear from Druid. Against a lot of classes like, let's say, Priest or Paladin, the AoE deals 2 damage, so it's quite easy to just kill the minion in stealth. Yeah. But how does a Druid remove a 4/2 stealth?
Not sure.
Really can't. Yeah, just need to taunt up and hope for the best.
Well, Hoy dropping this Lothep here, locking out the spells from Oskaka, at least just for 1 turn. But Oskaka, even if he got the spells, he'd be in trouble anyways because he's at low health.
Oh man, what can you do here?
Well, he can't even really kill off the Lothep without committing a lot of HP, and even then, he's gonna have to use Ancient of Lords to heal defensively.
Unless he Ancient of Lords heals here, the game is gonna be over, but he knows that there's so many things in the Hunter deck that would end the game right here. Goes for the heal. Good for him, but probably not gonna be enough to take the game.
Okay. Now, there is something to consider. If Osaka can stall long enough on the board, he does have Force Nature Savage Roar.
That is true.
And, like, say, hypothetically, if he was able to use it next turn, that's 25 damage.
Or next turn, heal for another 5, make the trade. Just
not sneak a little bit of damage.
Not die is the goal here.
Just not die. The way to win, just never lose. Okay. Easy enough.
Easier said than done, especially against a hunter, which is really naturally prone for aggression. Hoi has to kind of budget exactly what he wants to do, too. For example, Unleash the Hounds right now does 2 damage. Does he want to commit to that? Does he want to save it in case his opponent builds up the board more? Does he quick shot now so he can get the mana out of the way?
Yeah, Unleash, not too bad here. It would have been a couple of extra points of damage, but the Keeper, I mean, the Creeper also.
Wow.
I mean, why not play that?
Okay, so Osaka draws 2nd Savage Roar. I'm not sure how much that helps, because how much damage does he have right now? 7 plus 6 plus 6, so that's 19, 20 damage.
It's not enough. But
a very pedestrian 20 damage, no big deal.
Oh man, that's such a great hand if he wasn't so low on HP. With that Emperor, the double combo would be easy to pull off, but there's no way he can go for an Emperor. This has to be a heal.
Exactly, but because he gets that damage in, let's say the hunter all-ins once more.
Yeah, and doesn't kill him. I think that would give him lethal. He would have 11 plus 14 from the combo. Yeah, that would be lethal for Osaka.
Yeah.
But for Hoi right now, how much is that?
He's got 5 on board plus
that
6,
is
11. But does he have enough mana to do everything?
Yes, he has exactly the mana for it.
All right. That should be enough then.
Wait, and does he?
Yeah, I think so. 2 quick shots plus hero power is enough.
That's exactly enough.
And Hoi does strike back and tie up the series. The hunter, being the hero, I know some people will be like, oh, Hunter won a game, but keep in mind, Hunter is not very common in the metagame, and in fact, Osaka was quoted saying, Hunter is unplayable currently.
Wow, well,
and his teammate uses Hunter to beat him. That's an even series, and we're going to game number 3.
Oh, that was quite a cool game.
It was. I think there was a lot of, I don't know if Hoi was aware of how close he actually was to dying.
It was so close.
Because if he was off by 1 damage and put him on to 1 HP, which is a very common move, because Druid used all of his heal, and if you put Druid at 1 HP, even if they heal power, you can use your hero power the following turn to kill him.
Right.
Now, if he did that, Osaka would have won, because he had the Force of Nature Savage for 25, and Hunter was at 24. So there was definitely that small window of opportunity. But when you're sitting on the other side, you're just like, yeah, I won. Oh, well, it's very one-sided. But you don't realize your opponent could have killed you the entire time.
Exactly.
Yeah. Very funny indeed.
Yep, 100 north away from Hoi. So Hoi has his Druid and Paladin, and Osaka has his Druid and Warrior.
Paladin's a very interesting class. I think Hoi also says that it's his favorite class. I don't want to say it's not his favorite, but it's definitely one of his favorites.
Oh, yeah.
And he brings it to almost every tournament. And I think one thing that's really interesting is when people hear Paladin nowadays, what deck are they thinking of, Savitz?
Mysterious Challenger.
The Mysterious Challenger. Well, I was waiting for you to say, none of your business.
But this actually might be a mid-range Paladin.
It might be a mid-range Paladin.
Yeah, I kind of like, I've been talking with some players, and I think mid-range Paladin, even though we don't see it all that much, it's actually not a bad pick at all, because a couple of decks that it does well against, Druid and Handlock are both really popular right now.
That's right.
And it has favorable matchups against those.
It's true.
But there's that bad Patron matchup, and right now, looking at the classes, I have to say that Osaka is the favorite because of the Patron and the Paladin from Hawaii. Because both the Mysterious Challenger Paladin and the mid-range are in bad shape if they run into Patrons.
I mean, it depends, too. Some Paladin players, when they're playing against Patron, even though they feel like it's a very difficult matchup, still feel like it's winnable for sure. I've talked to Strifecrow about it. I've talked to, Raynad about it. And they feel like, mid-range Paladin, if you can curve out very aggressively and make sure that your deck's built to beat the Patron, I mean, it's not unwinnable.
It's true. The reason why Paladin is usually not that good against the Patron is the way that Paladin deals the damage. They have to first get the minions on the board, and the Patron Warrior is maybe one of the best, if not the best, at keeping the board clear.
Yeah. You don't have to tell me that. I've experienced it enough times to absolutely believe you. Game number 3 is about to start here. Hoi's going to tag the Druid in and try to see if he can keep his momentum against Osaka. Osaka brings in the Patron because, statistically, it should be good against both of these decks. Although Druid is one of those classes where if you start asking them, how is your matchup against Patron, a lot of Druid players who really like the class say, you know what, I actually feel good against Patron these days.
Yeah, I feel good about it as well. It's a little bit interesting because it's tough to tell. Sometimes Patron just goes off on turn five and there's something like Death Spite set up on turn four, then turn five Patron inner rage and then use the Death Spite, and it can be completely impossible for the Druid to get the full clear.
But how often does that really happen?
Yeah, that's the big question.
That's almost asking, like, well, if you know the Hunter curves perfectly or the Paladin curves perfectly, yeah. It's like it doesn't happen every game.
It doesn't happen, no. Most of the games it does not happen.
And some Druids are even realizing that if you drag it on in a battle of attrition, and you force the Patron to be very aggressive, and you clear, and you're trading cards for cards, in a top deck scenario where you both have like one card or no cards, Druid's actually very good against Patron because Patron needs like four or five cards in order to dominate Druid.
That is true. Oh, going for the turn one Shade. That Shade is going to be there for
a while.
For a long time, yeah. That's going to get to be massive.
He brought
massive.
His tent.
Yeah.
Yeah. Although, I believe people who have been waiting in line for the Road to BlizzCon EU may have waited longer than this Shade. Some people here have been lining up for hours. Just a chance to be able to watch these games, check out the Hero Stage, play some Overwatch. It's really exciting to be here.
The crowd is absolutely amazing here for the Hearthstone sites. It's
true. You guys are awesome, by the way. Awesome to see such a packed house here in Prague.
Yep.
Going into turn number two, Hoi has the Darnassus Aspirant, and that's going to allow him to coin into the Lotheb and Azure Drake, but there is a weapon waiting for him on the other end.
There is. So. That's Shade from Hoi. It's exactly the start.
Oh, so he wants to bait him to kill the Shade and potentially save the Darnassus Aspirant.
He figures that he needs to keep the Aspirant so that he can play one of his fives next, and it's a really interesting decision because the Shade, it's impossible to remove as a warrior. They don't usually deck in the Brawl.
The Brawl could be a way, but I like this move. It's really smart.
I like it too, yeah.
Hoi's like, well, he's going to prioritize killing the Shade, which allows me to play a minion with 5 mana because I can coin the next turn.
This move was definitely not something that you should copy back at home. It is something that he did exactly because of the hand that he had.
Right.
With the double 5 drops and the coin, the value of getting that extra mana crystal was so high. He had no play this turn otherwise.
Oh, until it got Wild Growth, but even then, is that too slow? I mean, as a Druid, you want to be able to pressure the Patron, because look, now all of a sudden, sure, it's taking care of the board, but it's losing a lot of health. Lotheb's going to get an attack. Yeah. He's going to be in the mid-teens. You might have Force Nature or even just Savage War to kill him.
Right. Such a heads-up play. I'm still pretty impressed, because normally you're just impressed. Like, yes, I got the Shade. You just let it be there. But they are with that hand. Wow.
That one attack may have completely changed the early game outcome of this match so far, because Oskaka's got pieces of what he wants, but he's nowhere near where he wants to be stabilization-wise.
Oh, yeah. He needs a lot of time to get the job done, and Hoi is putting on so much pressure right now with that Lotheb.
Well, do you take care of the Lotheb? Do you try to go with Deathbite and set it up for the next turn?
Yeah,
it's very difficult to
think you do.
To weather this, because a lot of times you're thinking, I have this weapon equipped, I kind of want to attack with it, but at the same time you also want to be able to be prepared for the next threat.
Interesting. Getting the Cruel Taskmaster in the body. Okay.
This is definitely an Oskaka play.
Yeah, it sure is.
Whenever I watch Oskaka perform in tournaments, he always does. Like him and Strifeco and a few other players always just like, they take it such a different route that I'm not expecting at all.
Yeah, quite often you see Oskaka go for something that's not very obvious.
I was anticipating the Death Spite, but what this does is this actually puts enough power without committing his own life to challenge the Lotheb.
That is true.
And he does kill the Darnassus Aspirant. So he says, if you don't have a 4-mana minion or you can't play a minion, I'm going to control the state of the board and I'm going to be okay without dipping my life too low. So I think this is a really clever play from Oskaka.
Yep, and Death Spite is a card that if the game drags a little bit longer, then you will get to use both of those. Sometimes with weapons, when you have multiple weapons, something like this, but maybe there won't be enough time to play both of them, but in this
look
case,
at this, though. Wow. I mean, now he's going to clear the board and be a little bit healthier, relatively speaking, and Druid doesn't have a minion to play the next turn.
Nothing for Hoi next turn.
And
obviously, he might draw something from the top, but right now it's just looking like a hero power.
I mean, these turns are what really makes a lot of the subtleties of playing this kind of warrior very difficult. He trades into the Armorsmith.
Yeah.
He doesn't want him to get any opportunities to gain too much life.
Or Battle Rage.
Battle Rage. You're very correct. Battle Rage is the key to being able to draw very early on.
Yep. There's the full clear from Oskaka, and it's looking great for him right now.
If you're a Hoi fan, you cross your fingers.
Hoi with the double Wild Growth. That is miserable.
Well, I've heard once upon a time that Druid was 28 cards in Wild Growth, but that's not exactly the kind of card you want to see this stage of the game.
Not at all. goes for one wild card. He knows that there's two Ancient of Lore's. He had an Ancient of Lore, at least one. So there's, wow, there's that, and Dr. Boom. This is so many things. Getting a wild card preemptively.
Auskaka just picked up the Grim Patron, which means now he can reduce the cost of both of them and have a lot of opportunities to play make.
Wow.
And Hoi wants to kill that Emperor Thoris, and he knows, yes, Patron doesn't have many cards, but if he's reducing cards that are very effective, it's going to be trouble.
Sylvanas from the top, that's something that he would have loved to have last turn.
Right.
Now it's a bit weird.
Yeah, the Sylvanas, you could say, well, you know, maybe he would have killed it, but no, then you force the Deathbite reaction, mm-hmm, and he doesn't have it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is going to hopefully force his opponent to trade into the Sylvanas, so that way he doesn't get the second Emperor Thoris in effect.
Could he just, like... No, he goes for the Patron. So, I mean, I think you've got to go for the Patron.
He just drew Whirlwind. That's seven mana.
Yeah, it's a Whirlwind draw.
That's almost too perfect.
Yeah.
On average, it should steal a Patron.
Why? Only with three cards. Cannot combo yet. Only eight mana next turn.
Right.
Getting those four Patrons on the spot. So potentially trading in the Emperor for the Sylvanas first. I mean, you don't want the Sylvanas to steal anything. Yeah. And you don't really care about the Emperor discounts anymore. Attacking face with the weapon, Grim Patron first, obviously, and then attacking face with the weapon, going for the whirlwind. Four patrons.
Yeah.
Putting the sunglasses on.
It's almost too good. Yeah. You know, at first I was thinking, yeah, maybe you don't worry about trading Sylvanas, but at the same time, just Patron Flood and try to pressure your opponent this way.
Yeah. First time today we see everyone get in here.
A sight a little bit too familiar for some players on the top of the ladder here, considering that this is the most dominant board presence that you can expect against Druid in this matchup.
Absolutely.
Although, how big was that draw there? Does the Wrath really help him to clean up?
It's not good enough. There's no way to get a full clear here.
That's true. It's just a little bit too much health on one of the patrons.
Yeah.
Because the swipe, it ultimately creates more patrons, and it's like, well, it's a never-ending problem.
The swipe doesn't accomplish anything, really.
But do you Wrath for one to draw, or do you think of killing the patrons a big priority?
I think he has to Wrath for one. It's desperate, but what else can you really do?
If you Wrath for one, hopefully you pick up a minion. We do know that Hoi has Ancient of Wars, so actually he doesn't have enough mana to play that either.
He would be one mana short, but
oh,
still.
Oh, that's really unfortunate. Well, what does he draw then?
Ooh. Okay.
Okay, oh, so geez. He's going to kill everything except for one patron?
Yep. Hoping that Auskaka doesn't have a way to get more.
This is a scenario that we're talking about, by the way. If Patron can't really pick up... I mean, that Warsong Commander number 2 doesn't really help that much.
No, it doesn't. So that's going to... It's going to kind of work for Hoi. He only has a swipe and a wild card in his hand, but...
But in top deck scenarios where Patron can't really use four-card combos, Druid, if he just picks up a good minion, will be in a pretty decent spot.
Yeah. Top deck scenario is very good for
unless he just gets Battle Rage right here. That's really scary.
If he gets it, that'd be crazy. Or Inner Rage.
That works.
That's decent.
Yeah, that works.
Let's still get the Inner Rage from the inventor. The card he wants to find right now is either Whirlwind or an Inner Rage.
And this is still something that Auskaka is just using to pressure his opponent. He knows even if his opponent, Hoi, had the Force of Nature Savage, he's still in the clear.
Right, and one Force was just used.
Mm-hmm. Would you use the Savage Roar here to kill off the Warsong Commander? Is that a high priority? Or do you feel like it's not as much of a big deal? I want to save it for something else.
I mean, it's desperate times. I would probably just go for it. But I can also understand if he wanted to hold on to it.
Right. That Warsong Commander is one of the keys to how the deck operates.
The fact that
it gives almost everything in a deck charge outside the Emperor Thoris is such a big deal. And you don't necessarily want it to live so that way it can do more damage to you.
Mm-hmm. Do you just play all the minions or Deathbite? Okay. Deathbite Acolyte. I guess that sets up lethal.
He swiped. He wrathed. What else do you kind of want?
Yeah.
So I think going forward is okay. I think Auskaka also realizes maybe this Frothing Berserker is just the key to winning, so I don't have to overextend. If I played it and for some reason he was able to kill it,
makes sense. And with the Deathbite and the Acolyte, even if there was a Harrison Jones, the Acolyte would just throw an extra card, so it's not all bad.
Hoi really wants that Ancient of War or something to stop bleeding. He's at 9 HP, and he needs to keep every single point.
I think it's too late for it, yeah.
And I think that should wrap it up.
That should do it.
Because no matter what, the Keeper of the Grove can't remove every minion on board, and the Frothing Berserker is just going to gain too much damage by doing so.
Right. I guess in theory, if he went for a Force of Nature to clear... No, he cannot clear even. Because they're both of those minions. Even though Force of Nature is kind of 6 damage, you can't divide it 3 and 3.
No, it just doesn't work that way. The 2-2 no. Treants. And Hoi, by playing a minion, also empowers the Frothing Berserker. So even though he denies a draw, Oskaka just has the last 2 cards. So it was a limp to the finish here. But the Patient Warrior got the job done. And I like the fact that Oskaka found a way to stabilize the damage, because Hoi did have a good start. He had Darnassus Aspirin, he had Innervates. He found the Wild Rose eventually, but he did have that curve that he was looking for.
Really well played by Oskaka. It's impressive to watch him play Patrons. In Archon League, I believe he went 8-0 with the deck, or was it 7-0?
Something absurd.
It was completely ridiculous.
All right, that wraps up game number 3. Oskaka going to go in for the damage. The Frothing Berserker, not the 25 damage Berserker, but just a meager 7 to the face.
That's good enough.
Coming into this tournament, Oskaka was a player that people had heard about. In fact, Oskaka finished very high on the ladder, but one thing that was interesting to me was that Oskaka, he acquired most of his points through ladder achievements on North America.
North America, yeah.
Yeah, he didn't actually ladder on Europe very often. And I think he was quoted as saying the reason why he did that is because he says, NA is easier. don't tell them. They're sleeping right now, so no NA players are going to get Jimmy's rustled.
Yeah,
but he thinks EU is much better than NA.
Either that or just that there's less players in there. But that also shows how serious Oskaka is about the game. He's choosing to play on a region just based on the numbers to get those higher legend rankings and make it here. I mean, it seems to be paying off right now. He got those points and now he's here.
Yeah, he did, and he finished number 3. He finished like top 10 a few times. I mean, number 3 is the highest I think he finished, but ultimately he was always in there for the top 100 rankings, but even in the top echelons of the top 100. Very fantastic ladder player. In fact, there was a rumor one time in the middle of the year that I think for the first quarter or first half of the year, Oskaka was statistically the best ladder player in the world.
Wow.
And that was just kind of like a little nudge at Blizzard. I was like, well, Blizzard, who do you think is the best ladder player? And they're like, well, we have the statistics. And we said Oskaka performed like one of the best seasons to date in terms of just sheer win percentage. So he comes in here as a player that's just played a huge amount of games, who's grinded it out, and has learned everything through science, experimenting, trial and error. And that's why whenever I see him make plays, it's like, well, this is not the first time he's done it.
And he's so good with all sorts of combo decks. The decks that I've been most impressed to see him play have been Miracle Rogue, when it was still a thing, and Freeze Mage. Unfortunately, Freeze Mage is right now in pretty bad shape because of the popularity of Druid and Warrior, which are the most popular decks. So he chose not to bring the Freeze Mage here. It would have been a bad decision overall. But that's one of the decks that Oskaka really shines with.
It's match point here for Oskaka. If he wins this next game, he will be in the winner's match. This is not elimination just yet. Mm-hmm. We're in a group stage. The way it's going to happen is we have 8 players, and we have 4 going to BlizzCon. Mm-hmm. And they just have to advance from their groups in double elimination. But it's easier said than done. I mean, Hoi is putting up quite a good fight. I love some of the plays that he made. But it's very clear that Oskaka was in a good spot. This is a matchup that, you know, we were going to say is probably going to define the entire series. Whoever comes out ahead in this Druid versus Druid could be the one deciding it. Although, I mean, you're never sure how it's ever going to go because Druid versus Druid is very volatile.
Right, and we don't know what kind of Paladin Hoi is bringing, but I would still say both the Mysterious Challenger Paladin and Midrange Paladin, I would slightly favor for the Paladin, but it's not like one of those matchups where, for example, like Freeze Mage against Warrior, it's not like that. But it's slightly favored.
All right, well, Hoi, he's going to go first. The player that's usually going first, I always feel a little awkward because now with the Darnassus Aspirin, it gives you multiple ways to ramp very well, so that way you can use your coin effectively, whether immediately or later on.
That's really interesting.
It gives you an extra card to get that ramp.
I like that logic. Unless I'm playing a combo deck, like Rogue, for Rogue you want the coin.
Mm-hmm.
But for a deck like Druid, I haven't thought about it that way. But yeah, I kind of like it because of the 4 ramp cards right now.
Although there is, you know, the logic, well, if you go first, you technically already ramped. You get the Mana Crystal head. Oh, that hand, from Hoi, that's terrible.
Oh, you can see it on his face, too. He's not happy about it.
Well, Oskaka does get the Innervate.
Turn 3 Emperor, potentially.
Turn 3 Emperor followed by minions. One of the things about Emperor is that sometimes you get it out, and it's like, well, cool, Savage War costs 2 now.
Well, cool. Innervate costs negative one. It's like you don't really have anything that follows it up.
And it's so hard to remove swipe only deals for Wrath, Europa, also only four. It's the best answer to it is obviously if you have a minion on board already to extend the trade with something like Wrath. But he did have the option here to innervate coin the pilot of Shredder, but.
That's the dagger in the heart.
Oh, man.
Oh, Hoi picks up second Savage Roar. He's going to have to pray for Innervate next turn. That's going to be his ticket back into the game and pressure his opponent.
He has to find the Innervate, or at least a ramping card. Nostkaka, hero power here, not that strong, but next turn that the Emperor, it's going to be bad times for it's going to be bad times for Hoi.
That's right. I mean, one of those things where Hoi's like, whew, he didn't play anything. He also didn't have a ramp card this turn. But unless Hoi has a minion.
Oh!
How bad is this hand?
We are watching a slow and painful death of our Danish player, Druid. Oh man, that's two turns of hero powering. That's six mana crystals wasted.
He might have to hero power next turn as well. Turn four hero power. For Ostgaga, there's no decision here. There's no way
you. That hand is so good for Emperor Thorsen.
There's no way you play anything else but the Emperor here. Getting those discounts on five cards. Getting the 5/5 body on the board as well against the Druid, so powerful. And Hoi really needs to find an answer here, but what can he even get? A Keeper?
The Keeper probably is his best answer. Oh, Shade would have been very nice last turn.
Last turn, yes.
It would have been very nice last turn.
But this turn, I guess you have to go for it.
I kind of want to emphasize that not only did Hoi waste 7 mana crystals now, from the first 3 turns plus 1 this turn, but his opponent was able to gain 3 extra, plus the 5 that was reduced, plus another 6, or whatever, depends on what he reduces here. The Azure Drake's gonna most likely cycle through and pick up a card.
I would be shocked if he played anything else. Obviously, those Keepers don't have a target. The Shredder can be more difficult to remove, but getting that extra card also into the Emperor effect, in this case, Ancient of War, quite nice.
Wow, Hoi is definitely not happy to see that. A second Force of Nature. It's a very good poker hand, Savitz. That's about it.
And not so good in Hearthstone.
What can he do here?
It's absolutely miserable.
He has to remove the Emperor as a priority.
I think so too.
But that means you have to Savage Roar this turn.
It's so weak. Do you just go for Lotep and hope that Ostkaka has it?
Nothing?
Wild Growth. There's 6 cards. How can it be nothing?
If he has Wild Growths and Savage Roars and Force of Natures, but that also means you could die.
Yeah, that's
because he just had 2 sweeps of Emperor Thorsen effect. I like the more aggressive approach, but Hoi, it's a very futile effort. Force of Nature comes in the hand, and another turn of Emperor Thorsen will be coming down.
Yep. 2 mana Shredder. Could even go for one of the Keepers if he wants to.
Yeah, I mean, considering that Keepers at this point will be effective to just silence something as well. You can keep one so that he only plays 1 taunt target. I don't mind that at all.
I would probably throw one of them out there just for the 2/4 body mostly. I mean, you get the battle cry 2 damage somewhere. You can trade in the Drake for the Lotep if you want to, but definitely the Shredder.
Sure.
That's the Keeper.
Okay. I'm down for it. Honestly, almost anything that loads up the board so that way you can just pressure your opponent is good enough for me.
Yep, I like it as well.
And another turn of Emperor Thorsen. That is way too many mana crystals. That's upwards like 15 to 20 mana ahead right now.
Oh, yeah.
But, Savitz, if Hoi comes back from this position, he's like the greatest Druid player of all time.
Absolutely.
I have no clue how many games this has happened and another person's able to come back from it.
I mean, there might be a Doomsayer in the Shredder, and then somehow he manages to deal with all the minions from Ostkaka.
It is true. There always is the Pilot Shredder potential, you know, disaster for Ostkaka. All right, so Force of Nature comes out. He has to try to deal with this a little bit. The good news is that he's not actually going to just die straight up, because even though Emperor Thorsen reduced a lot of card costs, ultimately it's not like the 2 Savage Roars and Force of Nature just kills you.
Only had one combo piece and only 1 discount on that as well. 0 mana Wrath, 1 mana Big Game Hunter. Wow.
Yeah, that's pretty mana efficient, considering that he can squeeze in other stuff too. Now, I mean, what if Ostkaka gets kind of wasteful though and the game slows down? It's pretty hard to imagine, but let's see here. What's the best course of action? Just Ancient of War and the Wrath.
I think so. Good. Unless you expect your opponent to maybe having decked in a Black Knight, but I don't think so. Oh, big game hunter, that's aggressive.
That's really aggressive.
I like it, yeah. With the Zero Mana Roth, he can do it.
So does he have lethal next turn if he does this? He's going to put his opponent down to 17, and he'd have 19 damage the following turn. Nope, 20 damage to the hero power. So it's a very good calculation from Osgaka. He's positioning himself to kill his opponent.
Yep, it definitely is enough. He can even silence Taunt if Taunt wants to come down.
That's a lot of board pressure, and Osgaka looks like he wants to wrap up the series by setting up a two-turn lethal. Even if his opponent played Dr. Boom, which is what the big game hunter is for, he doesn't care. He's going to kill his opponent.
That's going to be it. There's no way for Hoya to survive this. Survive the next turn from Osgaka.
Yeah, the Keeper of the Grove will silence past his taunt, and Osgaka just got his first match win here in the Road to BlizzCon. A sigh of relief, as he knew that it wasn't exactly as easy as it looked.
Yep, there we go.
All right, so Hoy tried his best, but just too much momentum on the Druid side, too many mana crystals reduced, and that's going to wrap up the first series of the day here. Immediately walking over and shaking his hand, very good sportsmanship from Hoy. He's not out just yet.
Nope.
He will have another series over in his group. We do have to find out what's going to be happening. But for now, the moment belongs to Osgaka, who did a fantastic job. Love a few of his small nuanced plays and really giving an advantage in the series.
Yeah, like playing the big game hunter, they're really aggressive, but he knew that he was in position to do it. Why would you keep it? What would you even keep it for? Dr. Boom? If you play Dr. Boom, you're just gonna win the game anyway.
Absolutely. And there's a lot of decisions you can ultimately argue back and forth, but I do like the idea that Osgaka played very strong to his win conditions and was very consistent. We do have to, you know, also feel a little sad. It's like, well, Hoy didn't bring Warrior. Maybe he was trying to kill the Warrior lineups and it didn't work out. Yeah. So I'd like to see Hoy come back, try to rebound from this loss and be able to show strong for a person who didn't bring the Warrior class.
I mean, if you Hoy, I don't think you can be too sad about that series, like the way you played. You can't be too upset at yourself. Like that last game, the draw was so horrible.
Yeah.
There's nothing that he can do to affect it. It was not his fault that his draw was bad.
We talk about like the optimal draws. How often does that happen with like patrons and, you know, whirlwinds? How often does that draw happen when you just like draw nothing, no ramp, no minions to play, all combo pieces? Very difficult. Nimsh, how does that series look from your end?
It was amazing. I really loved the series. There was a lot of class variety. We've seen Druid and Druid, we've seen Patron, we've seen Priest, and also Hunter. So overall, I think a really interesting match from those players.
One thing that is interesting to me specifically is that Hoy did not reveal his Paladin. We didn't actually see what it is, so he does have that information advantage going to his next series, and that might help him. You know, every little bit will matter in the early game choices, which ultimately could determine the series.
That is, as you said, it can be Mistress Challenger, but as Savitz mentioned, it can be also the midrange Paladin, so there is a lot of surprise effects, and that's something that can give you an edge in this tight environment when you're facing the pro players. The knowledge and something that your opponent doesn't know.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, we had really fun this series. I'm looking forward to it. What do we have coming up next here, Nimsh?
Well, we had Thais versus Maverick play offstage. I'm not exactly sure what the score right now, but we will have Osgaka play versus the winner and Nahoy play versus the loser of that match. I'm not exactly sure what's the next match, but I want to hear from Osgaka, the winner. So, Rachel, take it away.
Thanks so much, guys. I'm down here on the stage with Osgaka, and dude, you had probably the toughest match or the first match of the day. You're going up against your teammate. What did you have to do to prepare yourself?
Well, Hoy actually plays a very specific lineup. He doesn't bring Warlock or Warrior, so kind of all the preparation that I had before I knew that I was playing him, you know, it all just went out, and then I had to do everything over again. But I think I got a favorable lineup versus him with the Priest, and I mean, the last game with Druid was a little bit unfortunate for him, so, but the Patron and the Priest pulled through pretty well, I think.
Yeah, I found it interesting that the casters mentioned that you don't really have a great opinion of Hunter currently, and Hunter was the only match that you lost, so talk to me about that.
Well, I mean, it happens. Like, Druid is one of the better matchups for Hunter, I think, and especially like the mid-range version. It's not a bad deck, but I think it's not the absolute best.
Well, I want to know, you guys are recent teammates. Have you had any chance to practice together, or are you still kind of flying independently right now?
Well, just because we were facing each other, we didn't get to practice much. I mean, a little bit back and forth, but specifically for this event, we couldn't practice with each other.
Well, is there anyone you're looking forward to facing in your group, or anyone you're particularly worried about?
Yeah, both of them are really, really strong, Maverick and Thais, so either one works.
Either one works. Well, we'll see who goes on to face Osgaka in the next couple matches. And casters, I'm going to give it back to you.
Thank you, Rachel. Well, so that was the first match of the long day. We're going to have six more matches today, and we are going to have the final tomorrow. So how do you guys feel about Prague overall? Because we are here, this event in Prague, in Czech Republic, and it's an amazing city and amazing Hearts and Games.
And Prague is beautiful. This is my second time here, and when I just get to walk through the old town, being able to, you know, check out the different parts of Prague and see just everything from the culture to the buildings and being able to see the landscape, it's a wonderful city. I think that it's really cool to see some people show up to, and people are very excited, they're cheering. You heard that roar for Life Coach. I mean, we heard it. I hope the stream was able to catch it too. A lot of people here really love to just see what Blizzard's able to do here for the Road to BlizzCon. It's such an honor to be part of it.
Absolutely. The audience is amazing. And Savit, how do you feel in front of this huge audience?
It's just amazing. I've been to many events, but nothing quite like this. It's astonishing.
He's jealous. He wants to be playing. I mean, that's kind of one of those things where, I mean, Savit and Nish, both of them have played a lot, you know, both for Hearthstone and other games too, but it's really cool. It's a little bit envious too, because these guys, you know, they're here competing not just for BlizzCon spots, but there's also a lot of money on the line. It's $25,000, $10,000 to the winner, and for most people, that's a huge opportunity to continue to secure their winnings for the year.
Absolutely, but mostly they want to qualify for the World Championships in the United States. And there is also the title that we talked about in the very beginning, the European champion, the first European champion, and it's going to stick for the next years.
That's right, that's right.
All right, so that was the first match. We're going to have much more action for you guys, but right now we're going for a short break. Stay tuned, stay with us.